Ayla panted, puffing strained breaths through her nose as her legs pumped beneath her, accelerated beyond natural speed. Four of the armored fanatics turned, as if sensing her approach, all three wielding melee weapons, while the fourth among them hefted a thickly decorated flamethrower. The sisters spread out as much as they could as she closed with them, weapons raising as they screamed mindless fury and countercharged. Ayla extended her hand, crashing into the four of them with a wave of concussive force. Not a one buckled, and from among the four, the sister bearing the flamethrower seemed to suddenly glow, crowned by a bright, pitiless light. The Jedi cursed under her breath, throwing another pillar of force out, but this time down into the ground at her own feet. Pitching herself back just ahead of the suddenly living flames which poured out of the woman's weapon. The fire pursued her in the shape of angels and twin-headed eagles which writhed and rolled as they came on, seeking to catch her inside the pursuing heat before she managed to outdistance its range. She withdrew her mind from the force around herself, sealing herself off preemptively before the psychic sense of the being behind the flame could reach out and touch her. Already this, or things like it, had begun to happen all across the field, turning sure victories into quagmires or outright defeats. But where Ayla had been able to break the minds of the flagging Imperial Psykers before, merely by use of their own fear of the Force, the same techniques were proving less than useless against these Sisters of Battle. For one thing, they were not Force-sensitives themselves, but rather conduits to something or someone that was. Her thoughts were briefly called back to the ritual mind slavery and corrupt dark side siphoning that the Sith often used in the past to strengthen the power of a single individual. She had received limited training after becoming a Jedi Master in the recognition and disruption of such abilities. But here, her training and disruptive techniques were proving less than useless. For though the power she beheld in the sisters seemed related, in a mechanical sense, to those ancient Sith techniques, they were fundamentally different in one major way. The Sith used such powers to take from the weak and give to the strong. To join the power of many powerless persons in order for their strength to be consumed by the will of another greater master. This was clearly the reverse. An unfathomably powerful force wielder was joining their mind and strength to those of the Imperial faith, a power and technique Ayla had never even conceived of. She had come in contact with the presence within that power twice now, and had been forced to flash burn her mind each time in order to continue fighting. As such, the Jedi Master knew very little about it, aside from that just the memory of it was enough to all but crush her under its psychic weight, much as the other foul force-wielding Imperial had before. Against these powers, Ayla had little recourse but to flee. Luckily, she was not on this battlefield alone, as the sisters discovered when they made to pursue her retreating form. A cascade of mortar fire flew over her head even as she threw herself back, the explosives colliding with the group of Imperials in a destructive pinpoint barrage. The metal beneath the armored feet of the sisters split and melted, breaking into pieces and forcing them down, chunks of their ceramite armor flying free as the first cascade of clone munitions was followed by a second rain of death immediately after. Clawing the ground, kicking the broken earth, and making headway, the three melee-armed Imperials charged ahead in spite of the shells, making a beeline for the Jedi, who had rebounded back in their direction after the second explosive volley, getting between the fanatics and the firing lines of her clone troopers. The mortars ceased their discharge as the general came close to the action again. But just as the clones dared not fire their weapons so close to their general's line of attack, so too was the flamethrower-wielding warrior choked by the sudden proximity of the other sisters to the Jedi, and both sides could only watch what happened next. Against Ayla's precognitive strikes, the melee sisters wilted, the Jedi playing their frenzy against them as she stepped with azure grace and wove herself between them and their furious strikes. The halo of light around the flamethrower-bearer had died away by the time she was done with the first three, and Ayla led the fight towards the remaining sisters without losing a step. These four were at the tail end of a vast, retreating line of Imperial forces, who were suddenly and violently shoved back into an outright rout by the arrival of the Jedi General and the main column of her clone forces. They had advanced so far that the shining, gold, and skull-adorned gates of the Imperial Temple were now clearly in sight. Even so, Ayla knew she had to maintain an ironclad discipline over her pursuit, allowing the Imperials to create their openings and riding the flow of the battle into each presented vulnerability, always balancing on a knife's edge. Though unaided by the Force, each of the Imperials was easily a match for any Mandalorian warrior when it came to the tenacity and focused fury of their attacks. The flamethrower-bearing sister discharged her weapon the instant her sisters fell, and the Jedi responded by throwing her lightsaber directly into the onrushing gout of painful death, and cutting the cone of fire which extended itself out from Ayla into two halves, riding up the stream of flame before meeting the nozzle of the weapon and cutting it clean in half. The strike left a jagged, molten line of damage across the breadth of the thick, fiery weapon, its fuel spilling and burning for a couple of stilted seconds. The saber arched back through the air, landing in Ayla's palm a millisecond before the sister and her inhuman weapon combusted. The Jedi slumped her shoulders, breathing hard and raising an aching hand to wipe grimy sweat from her head. This was the most intense fighting she had ever been a part of, and already the Jedi Master could feel herself being stretched beyond her competency. Forced to reach levels of martial prowess the Confederacy had simply never forced out of her. But, she reflected, at least they were winning. Or so she believed. That belief was contested and even shattered as the buildings to either side of the avenue her army was marching down suddenly lit up with weapons fire. A wide ambush was suddenly sprung, and the retreating fanatics they'd been chasing wheeled about, revealing their retreat to be a lethal feint. Like the two crushing pincers of a sand shrike, the Imperials who had taken up positions in the flanking buildings had remained hidden and inactive, allowing the Republic to overextend its advance. Once they had, these new Imperial fighters hammered into the flanks of the clone column while the sisters began to countercharge, clearly intending to ram into the front of their now assailed force with renewed vigor. Ayla had to think quickly if she wanted to rescue the front end of her column, reaching for her comm and beginning to relay orders, dodging and backtracking all the while.
Aquila squad, go to the right flank with the detachment of whatever you need. Take those attack positions while I handle the ones on the left.
She commanded, looking around, eyes widening as she scanned her surroundings until she spotted what she was looking for and took off at a run. Dodging shots from either side, spinning forward in the air in a cascading, rolling vault as the battle built up even more friction, the two armies colliding like storm fronts. All the while, bolts and lances of weaponized light and plasma sped past her, warming the moist after-storm air as she threw herself high into the sky. Her leap arced up unnaturally, bolstered with a powerful exhalation of the Force. She flew up into the empty air, her momentum letting her hang for a few moments as the path of her fall was intercepted at the halfway point by the straight, strafing runs of an attacking wing of LAAT gunships.
Seizing the rim of one of the crew hatches, she hauled herself up inside, a roughed-up team of clone troopers turning to face her with hidden, bewildered expressions. Spin us around! We've got to move now if we want to save the left flank! Take us in towards the Sakul Transit Center, now!
She ordered, gesturing towards one of the occupied buildings.
Yes, General!
The commanding clone said with a salute before contacting the pilots and informing them of their new objective. However, no sooner had the message been relayed than a sudden, jarring thump shook the gunship. A moment later, the vessel soaring directly to the right banked suddenly and dove into the street below, slamming down amidst the fighting forces, its fiery body tumbling and twisting in an ocean of bodies. Ayla did not ignore this, looking out at the other ships in their formation and gasping at what she saw happening there. The armored Imperial fanatics had launched themselves from the battle below on jetpacks, and, upon reaching the right altitude, had done much as she herself had. Across most of their fellow gunships were adhered Sisters of the Imperial Faith, armed with blazing, blue power swords or fat, one-handed guns clenched in each fist. Their boots seemed magnetized and half stood on the hulls of the LAATs, firing their weapons into the ships they stood on, or tearing into the metal beneath them with their wicked melee weapons. Right away, Ayla realized what this could mean and stuck her head out of the cabin of the gunship looking back. Sure enough, hers had also been caught by the flying zealots, and two sisters clung to the vessel. The first of them stood on the main body of the ship, her sword glowing bright blue and wreathed in lightning. The sister stalked forward, walking on the side of the ship thanks to the magnetic locks on her boots. But she was not the most immediately threatening. The other sister had landed on the right-hand wing, and Ayla watched helplessly as the clone within the wing turret was blasted by the two guns of the fanatic. The explosive bullets turning him into a mess of organs, torn flesh, and shattered armor. The crazed Imperial clearly had no intention of stopping with just him, however, letting the two automatic weapons begin strafing up the length of the wing. She was stopped just short of shearing it off the gunship when Ayla's thrown lightsaber spun past the Imperial, taking her arms off with it. Hand extended, Ayla called back her lightsaber, struggling to keep track of the blue blade in order to pull it back into the speeding, shaking ship. The distraction was so great it nearly killed her. The Jedi's life narrowly avoiding its end as the clone captain behind her grabbed her roughly by the back of her vest and yanked her further into the ship. The jarring move pulled her inside and threw her onto her back, just out of reach of the First Sister's blade. The woman having reached the lip of the hatch near Ayla and nearly beheading her shortly after. Ayla closed her eyes, keeping a hold on her saber, now twice as hard without a visual line of sight on it. But she and her kyber crystal were strongly tied together, especially after all that had happened to both of them in this battle, and she managed it, though, again, it took all her focus, drawing the blade closer and closer to the flying hull of the LAAT. In that time, the sister pulled herself into the ship cabin, magnetized boots adhering her to the ceiling in place of the ground. It made little difference. The clones raised their weapons, shouting half-spoken war cries using maximum blaster settings and stun settings. Neither had the desired effects, failing to even slow the sister down as she wove her blade through them, silencing the clones seconds before turning to the Jedi who yet remained. She charged the short distance over to the ceiling of the gunship's cabin and leapt, deactivating her magnetized boots in order to land on the ground and, if possible, atop the prone alien woman. Ayla spoiled this plan by rolling to the side, throwing herself out of the gunship. For a few heartrending instances, the Jedi Master was free of all bonds, twirling in the air, her mind only half residing in her body. Her saber came flying out of that space like a rocket propelled on a bright blue engine. and her waiting hand seized it, scything her to the side thanks to its momentum, allowing her to reach out. She took hold of the back end of the LAAT and adhered herself there with the force. The sweat coating every inch of her was wicked off in the screaming wind, Leku flailing in the harsh, cold air. The ship wobbled and bounced beneath her, still afloat in spite of the damage it had taken earlier. For a moment, Ayla expected the sister to destroy the ship from within it, and thought she would be unaware of the Jedi's successful escape. But she was wrong on both counts. Leaping out of the cabin and catching herself on twin wings of fire, the sister twirled up and landed ahead of Ayla on the roof of the gunship, touching down while facing the Jedi. The blue alien watched the boots of her foe magnetize, electrical currents visible as they bound the powered armor to the hull of the gunship, and was grudgingly impressed as the sister stalked forward, her footwork hardly impaired by it. Ayla could only hope that she proved to be just as impressive. There was a brief moment of bizarre tranquility amidst the chaos as both warriors took the measure of the other. The wind howled, the battle raged like a sea of violence around and beneath them. Yet, in that moment, none of it existed, as the two warriors focused down on each other and then, moving in unison, charged. Saber plasma kissed sword blade as the two masters collided, rolling and striding across the back of the wavering LAAT like performers on a familiar stage. Ayla rolled her body about the narrow space, using her metaphysical bond to its hull to her full advantage, altering her inertia and the push of gravity to keep her returning to the ship even as she leapt and slid across it. Without the Force, the Imperial was left without any such options for maneuvering, and was made to keep at least one foot upon the ground at any given time to keep from being swept away. And yet, in spite of this impairment, she met Ayla blow for blow and strike for strike. The sheer shock of it was almost enough to drive the Jedi Master out of her flow. Unable to understand how this mere human woman was managing to keep up with, much less challenge her. And challenge her she did. The woman was a hammer, a furious combatant who never let up and never staggered. It was as though this Imperial had spent vast stretches of her career fighting and killing foes who were both far more mobile than she was and presumably just as deadly. It was as though this Imperial had spent vast stretches of her career fighting and killing foes who were both far more mobile than she was, and presumably just as deadly as the burning touch of any lightsaber blade. Ayla found her offenses repelled and countered, and then, after having spent her momentum, was quickly driven into the defensive. Raising her blade in desperate delay of death, Ayla felt the advantage leaving her side. What was this strength? What was this power that allowed this armed but mundane woman to defy her, where others touched by the Force had not been able to? But defiant though she was, Ayla knew the answers already and simply did not want to face them. She and the Order had been arrogant. They had come into this battle wearing robes, armed with swords and little else, and to keep up the fight like this enemy was demanding much more of her than she could bring to the fore and maintain. Exhausted down to her bones, she was seconds away from an act of desperation, when the need for it was removed, and the situation she was mired within deepened in its severity. The gunship had finally reached the building on their flank, flying over the roofs and walkways the Imperials occupied, raining death down into the body of the clone advance and, soon, up at the gunship. It was not long before the Jedi and Sister of Battle, currently locked in a vicious struggle, were forced apart by a sudden and wild bucking, as the ship underneath them was pelted with munitions. The LAAT maintained its altitude for only seconds more before the damaged wing it had been limping on gave out completely, and the ship began to freefall out of the air. The sister took off in a spiral of flame and smoke, leaving Master Ayla to her fate, a fate she fought against, running down the length of the falling ship at a full sprint. Without hesitation, she threw herself from the nose of the LAAT, spinning into the open air, arms tight against her chest as she pulled her momentum in. Around her, other gunships flew past, depositing their troops via ascension cables onto the contested roofs and access points. Many burning and bursting apart, naked before the vindictive return fire of the Imperial forces. Beneath the dervishing spin of the Jedi's body, the Imperial counterattack was sinking its fangs deep into the head of the Republic force, tearing away chunks in fiery, concussive displays of fanatical aggression. All of this flowed into her overburdened mind, and all of it needed to be pushed back and away as she extended her hand, just barely catching the piped lip of one of the buildings she had come to take back. The Jedi Master groaned, dazed, hanging for a few moments. What remained of the sweat and rain dripping off her as she clung, pipe clutched in one hand, inactive saber squeezed in the other. Calling upon the Force, she hefted herself up over the lip and was met with immediate attack. The Imperials she faced now were, again, a new variant she had not encountered before. Covered head to toe in metal and rubber hazmat suits, their faces hidden behind blocky, rectangular screens, these new human beasts silently attacked, voicing no words or cries in odd contrast to their kin. Though, they came on with the same determined assault as the Imperials who had come before them. A man attempted to lance and shoot her point blank with one of their directed energy weapons. Having already been standing feet from her when she hauled herself up, she sliced off the front of his gun and bisected him in the following instant. But no sooner had his torso fallen away than that she was now facing a volley of light-speed beams of deadly light. Ayla ducked, already moving before the shots had been fired, precognition barely keeping her a hair's breadth away from death. Thrusting her hand out and sending the dying soldier's fallen torso and standing legs hurtling through the air and into the dense clusters of attackers now facing her. This was not enough to avoid them shooting at all, however. And she was forced to keep moving, zipping, skating across the surface of the steel roof as the Jedi carefully danced about, continuously tangling the aiming soldiers in various crossfire positions, while throwing and pushing them with increasingly violent and unrestrained exhalations of the Force. Still, she would not have lasted more than a couple of seconds were it not for the clones who were fast coming to her aid, creating chaos as the enemy found their attentions divided between the alien menace and her army of clones. Even so, the fighting was desperate, and while the Imperials were gradually driven back, they made the clones bleed for every centimeter of metal they were forced to surrender. These cursed soldiers carried an aura about them as black as night, and they were silent, always silent, even as they were cut down, or did the cutting down. While they were armed with the standard Imperial fare, they also had terrible weapons among them, weapons which spat gouts of what appeared to be superheated stone. Ayla had watched as, time and again, these deathly, silent soldiers had charged near certain death, a few reaching the line of the firing clones and dousing them in the horrifying, burning excretions produced by the weapon. She had heard the dying, desperate screams of the soon immobilized clones who were the victims of these guns, who did not pass easily or quickly as the substance rapidly cooled and hardened around them, becoming moaning, crying blocks of cover for the advance of the Imperial soldiers. And yet, the true horror of her situation was not made obvious to her until after the clones had driven back the roof-bound Imperials, now able to begin the arduous process of securing the building they stood on, and therefore their flanks. She had stumbled to the nearby railings overlooking the battle, breathing heavily, feeling her body thrum with sore pain and growing exhaustion, and trying to rally. Instead, the sight there sucked her heaving breaths out of her lungs. The front lines had become a shamble, a disorganized melee which her determined forces were swiftly losing. They needed heavy armored support, and they needed it right away. Ayla's eyes scanned the column line and saw that much of her heavy support was held up in the mire of advancing troops. They were being ground to dust at that choke point. She reached for her communicator and activated it.
Commanders of the main column, this is General Sakura. You need to move all your infantry forces off the main street. If you are near to the besieged flanks, then breach the base of those buildings and begin fighting your way in. Otherwise, use side roads, street alleys, and bordering buildings. Armor commanders, I need everything heavy to the front. And I need them here 5 minutes ago. Prioritize the Juggernaut reserve units. Smash the enemy front and then deploy troopers to hold our gains. Hammer and hold again and again. We can win this if we hold to the plan,
she sent to them.
Yes, General,
came the unified responses from the commanders. She nodded as if to reassure herself and took a step before stumbling. Ayla fell to one knee, heart beating out of control in her chest. What was happening? The sounds of the battle around her were loud, smothering, booming, and yet another sound was rising in the background, slowly devouring the noise coming from everything else. A clone came to her side, one of the recently deposited from the newly arriving gunships. He took her arm, attempted to help her up, but she found the strength in her legs failing, faltering under her own weight as the power she had drawn into her beleaguered body was drawn from her like blood spilling out from a punctured throat. And the sound just grew louder and louder. And where before it had been indistinct, now she could make it out all too clearly. The sound of a billion voices, all crying out in despair, in pain, in sudden immutable terror. And then... Ayla sagged.
General? General, are you all right? Are you injured? Medic! Medic!
The clone was calling by her side.
I am fine.
She lied, finding at last the strength to stand and rising.
General, what happened?
The clone asked. She shook her head, lines drawn across her face as she attempted to absorb and understand the sensations which had just run through her, through every Jedi on the planet.
It was a disturbance, a great disturbance in the Force. It was as if countless voices cried out for aid, for help, and were suddenly silenced.
She said. The clone tilted his head. What does it mean, General? He asked. She did not answer him for a few moments, looking down at her hands, flexing her fingers, and then up at the sky. The clearing blue above rapidly finding itself choked and blocked anew by bars of black smoke.
It means things are moving around us, even while we are trapped here. It means we need to bring this fight to a close, sooner rather than later,
she said. The trooper nodded, and together they began to march towards the other waiting troops. And then the Jedi staggered again, and then, before she could even react, was struck a third time. But not by anything physical. The Master found herself on hands and knees, her soul sounding, resonating painfully in the wake of what she had just sensed. She saw her vision blurring for a moment, recovering more slowly this time. The medic did come, but there was little he could do to treat her, for even as Ayla recovered physically from the shock, mentally and spiritually, she remained decimated. How many echoes had she just felt? How many resounding cries followed by this horrid, freezing silence? Ayla and all the Jedi upon the planet were suddenly forced to harden themselves, or succumb in maddening despair to the truth the Force had revealed to them. A proclamation echoed in the voices of uncountable billions. What they had sensed was not the final shriek of a murdered planet. It was the death cry of several worlds. The mailed fist of distant Davik Thune was tightening around the Confederacy of Independent Systems. And as its bones began to snap, the Jedi bore terrible, distant witness to the end of the Clone Wars.
I'm sorry. I let it overcome me. I'm so sorry.
Depa groaned, cradled in Windu's good arm.
Shh, I understand. Please, don't speak. Save your strength.
Windu implored her, maintaining his strong face. But, in truth, he was breaking inside. The battle was over. Victory was theirs, and yet this was what they had to show for it. Jedi Master Depa Balaba lay before him, her legs torn apart at the knees, nearly every bone in her body broken or fractured. The sound of her voice was hard for him to hear, but her rattling laughter and subsequent coughs and breathing were even more terrible.
I cannot survive this. I'm sorry. Master Windu, you will have to continue the fight without me.
She rasped. The wounded Jedi smiled at him as much as she could, red dribbling from her crooked lips, her blood-filled eyes looking into his. Windu felt his face tense.
Do not mourn me,
she said softly.
Rejoice.
Windu nodded, recognizing this teaching of his order. I will. It has been an honor to know you in life, Master Depa Balaba. I will honor you and rejoice at your unity with the Force, said Mace, finding his resolve once more. She closed her eyes, and he could feel her slipping away. It took everything in him to retain his dignity then, as he held her, his friend fading from life in his arms. Her smile dissolved, and her bloodied eyes did not open again.
Mace,
she whispered, barely able to force the breaths up and out of her broken body. Yes, he said, leaning in to listen. She breathed, her spirit halfway departed, and spoke with a final, shuddering whisper.
Don't tell Caleb.
And with the exhalation of those last words, she did not breathe in again and passed. He held her body for a time longer before gently laying her down and standing, looking at her broken form. Was this what victory would look like from now on? Was this the face of the future? The bloody face of his friends and masters passed from life and into the Force? His simmering thoughts were drawn back and away from his ruminations when he heard the familiar voice of Master Obi-Wan Kenobi call for him. Master Windu, you are needed. Sighing through his nose, he gathered himself, and then, once sufficiently strong, turned and jogged over to where he, Jocasta Nu, and Stas Ali had gathered, which was around the wounded body of Jedi Master Jarro T'Pol. Master Obi-Wan met him just before he arrived, Mace slowing to consult with him.
How is he?
Whispered the senior master.
Not good.
Obi-Wan admitted.
Stas is doing what she can, but even she is being stretched thin at this point, and his wound is severe.
He continued. Mace nodded gravely.
Last words may be in order.
Kenobi added in a more softly spoken whisper. Master Windu paused and gave one more curt nod, and then turned to face the shuddering, ailing form of Jedi Master T'Pol. He came to his side, kneeling and taking the large Jedi's hand when it was offered, clasping it tightly. Master Jocasta stood back behind them, straight as a rod and watching on, while Stas was kneeled over T'Pol, bloody hands pressing to either side of the hole in his chest as she attempted to heal him. Master T'Pol, said Mace Windu.
Ah, Master Windu. One moment, if you will.
He said, pushing away Stas Ali with the burnt, blunt stump of his other hand.
That's enough, Ali. Save your strength for those that can benefit.
He said gruffly, pain constrained in every word.
But I can... She started to say, but he shook his head.
I am done, Master Ali. Say what you will about Master Dapa Balaba. She was never... found wanting with a saber strike. Go,
he said to her. Stas's face tensed, but she nodded and stood up, bowing and then turning away, unable or unwilling to watch.
How is she?
Master T'Pol asked after Master Ali had departed. Stas? Asked Windu.
No, I mean, Balaba.
The Lasat master clarified. Windu's face threatened to grimace, but he kept himself as placid as possible. She has passed. Master Depa Balaba has become one with the Force. He said. T'Pol did not hide his own grimace.
Damn! She would have been an asset. An asset in the war, or war that is coming.
He growled through obvious pain, his eyes milky white.
I can see it, Windu, as I lie here. So close to the end. I see so much. We were arrogant. Fought them like droids. Like separatists.
The master began to say. Windu watched on in stunned silence, clutching his friend's hand as his death delirium began to take him. Then, he was pulled close, T'Pol's large arm hauling him near the hole in his chest, the Lasat speaking into Mace's ear.
Listen to me. I can see it all so clearly now. The invaders... The Imperials, and the chaos that follows. It will swallow us whole if we do not discard our pride. It may have devoured us already. This war in the shadows.
Windu tried to pull back, but was held fast by a strength the Lasat should not have been able to muster in his wounded state.
What are you talking about, Master T'Pol? Mace asked stiffly. The dying master's head flopped to one side, and then the other, and his grip wavered, but then strengthened again.
It is a war we have not known, but one we have been fighting all along. But there is a new war coming. It's already here, in fact. A true war! To devour the secret war! We are at risk, Master Windu, of being consumed!
The dying master raved. I know, my friend, I know. I will safeguard the Jedi Order and the Republic. I promise, said Windu.
But, Master Windu, what if one must be chosen over the other?
The alien master said, weakening again. I will not let the Empire devour either. Mace assured. The dying master did something unexpected then, and grinned a red grin.
I was not speaking of the Empire.
He said, but did not elaborate, releasing his grip on the master and laying back more. Windu was sure this would be the last time he heard the Lasat master, but T'Pol did manage to speak one more time.
Cal Kestis, my Padawan.
The Lasat croaked. I will look after him. I'll make sure of it. Windu promised him.
Prepare him. Windu, prepare him. He's not ready. We are not ready.
Windu held the master's hand as he slipped away and remained for a time after. The other Jedi, those who could still fight, had gathered together now, standing in a loose circle around Windu and the fallen Jedi he mourned.
We are ready to move towards the bridge,
said Master Jocasta Nu, rifle still held in her hands.
No, we are not. Recover as many of our forces as we can. We're pulling out of this ship,
said Master Windu, his voice running over with spite.
Was it not the plan to take the ship?
Asked the elderly librarian.
The plan has shifted. Too much Jedi blood has been spilled. Too many of us have fallen to accomplish too little. The ship is crippled. What we have done is enough. Take our wounded and our dead and pull them back to the boarding pods. We are done here.
Jocasta nodded, and Obi-Wan voiced no complaint. For all they knew, there was another monster like this waiting for them at the captain's chair, and they could not continue to contend with this nature of warrior, not the way they are now. The thoughts drew Mace Windu's eyes back towards the slumped corpse of the space marine they had vanquished. Still kneeling, held up by his powered armor, the man had died smirking at them.
Jocasta, assemble some of the able-bodied Jedi as well. We are taking this thing with us. We need to better understand our enemy. We need to adapt to what they are. He said, and the old woman nodded in stiff agreement. Javona was pushed into the wide, steel-barred room with the rest of the aliens. She had been found in the latest purge raids, and after a thorough interrogation, one which left her without three of her fingers, and covered in bruises, they had thrown her into a confinement cell, and let her sit without food, water, or medical aid for what she could only guess was hours or days. She had been so careful until now. She had managed to stay hidden for so long. But one mistake, one bad encounter, one report on her appearance, and they had come for her. If they had not been so sure she was part of a cell or group of her kind, then they likely would have killed her right there and then. And, of course, she was. But she'd choose a million deaths before betraying her family or her kind to the death-worshipping fanatics who had taken her. Javona had shivered as she contemplated such thoughts, for she knew that they may well attempt to force her through that very trial, if they could do so without her expiring. There were so few like her left now, after all the purges and the searches and the Space Marines. She had barely avoided them. Her skin color and facial features had always helped her pass for human much more easily than the rest of her family. An unrequested blessing she'd found herself relying on for her very survival. With that thought present in her mind, she unwove the loose turban she wore over her head, making her alien features more obvious to the others around her, putting them and herself more at ease. Since she was still dressed in the Imperial fatigues she had stolen for her disguise. The dirty, frightened faces around her, emaciated and discolored, softened right away with the revelation. In this horrible place, even being able to recognize your species was irrelevant. It was enough to not be human, or at least not Imperial human. Their hatred, their persecution, effectively made all who found themselves here of the same race. The door behind Javona slammed shut, making her jump and submerging her in darkness. The creaking of locks and seals activating and sliding into place sounded from where the door had been in the blinding darkness, and Javona was left blinking in shadows for almost 5 minutes before her eyes adjusted enough to allow her to see anything. The whole place was crowded, and it stank. Like her previous holding cell, there were no toilets, much less bathrooms, though the floor was coated in loose, dusty sand and plenty of worthless, discarded junk. While they were not pressed shoulder to shoulder, there was clearly not enough space for all of them to lie down, even if any of them wanted to make contact with the filthy floor. She walked, running her hands along the metal bracings of the oddly mechanical textured walls. So complicated. She wondered if this room had been repurposed into a general holding cell, and if so, what had it been before? She reached an odd detail then, a bulky, fist-sized nodule of metal, roughly round in shape and protruding 3 inches from the surface of the wall. She felt it out with her fingers, squinting at it. It had some sort of a hole near the top, and it almost looked like some kind of reinforced metal nozzle. A metal nozzle. On a wall. She squinted a little harder and looked down the length of it, noticing the vague lumps proceeding further and further down at regular intervals, the same pattern repeating above her head as well. Rows and rows of nozzles? Then, a sudden, sharp fear plunged into her gut, a freezing blade of revelation. She kneeled down, pinching some of the sand between her fingers and dabbing the digits against her tongue. Not sand. Ashes. She reached down further and grabbed one of the discarded items. Not an item, but a charred bone wreathed in burnt fiber. Terror thrilled within her as she stood up and looked around once more. This was not a holding cell. This was a death chamber. She ran as quickly as she could, reaching the door and yanking on it, fingers closing around the steel texture and rivets. It did not budge in the slightest, but it did blast her with a near lethal amount of electrical volts, sending her careening back against the crowd behind her. Smoking, twitching, the reason none of the others were attempting to assault their way out the door seemed clear enough. Again, she had no concept of how long it took her to recover and stand up, but the time was given over to her as she found herself still alive by then. She waited. They all waited. And waited. And waited. She would have thought they would get it over with quickly. Didn't the damned corpse worshippers have other people to burn to death today? But the sadistic captors seemed content to force them all to wait for their execution within the uncomfortable, cramped space. Soon, she began to wonder if they would all suffocate here, first from breathing each other's air, before finally there was the sound of a metallic thumping and clinking. She felt her bladder nearly go entirely weak at that moment, but held strong for long enough to realize it was the door in front of her making the noise, and not the walls around her. They were going to add someone else to the room. Javona decided in that moment that she would rush the door, regardless of the consequences. What was the worst they could do? Kill her? At least she would not be left waiting for death in this vile, stinking darkness. She braced herself for a run, crouching slightly. And when the light came through, blinding her temporarily, she ran at full speed, screaming as she charged into certain death, or at least severe pain. To her surprise, her body connected with one of the armored guards, and she, as well as the Imperial, went tumbling back and against the wall. They began to struggle then, Javona punching him twice and hurting her fists on his armor as she rolled on top of him. Eyes closed, she clung to the front of his vest, in no way a fighter, at least not before now. She expected to feel the hard smacking of an elbow or rifle butt into the side of her head. But, instead, she felt the light knocking of metal knuckles rapping against her head crest. She opened her eyes then, and gasped. "Hey, I'm guessing you don't like it in there very much. Would you like to, I don't know, get out of here?" asked the clearly non-Imperial soldier who lay beneath her, speaking the local language of the planet she had found herself on. A veritable waterfall of emotions fell through Javona at that point, tears which were already on her face intensifying, heart thumping as hope and disbelief conjoined there.
You're the Republic?
She managed to ask through clumsy Galactic Basic. "Well, close enough. My name's Kombir, and yours?" he asked.
"Javona,"
she said, blinking tears rapidly out of her eyes. "Nice to meet you, Javona. So, I hate to make any demands, especially of someone as, pretty as you, but, I've gotta get up and help my people finish the rescue," he said, still pinned beneath her. Javona blushed and nodded hastily, climbing back and off of him as well as rising to her feet. It was then that she noticed that they were not alone. Other men like Kombir, though dressed in an assortment of armor, were helping escort the other prisoners out of the cells. He rose, and after a while, was leading the escort that was taking them away, Javona not far behind. The corridors were scorched with weapons fire, and every couple of steps or turns, they would be forced to step over or trample a fallen Imperial soldier.
"You and these fight through the Imperium?"
she asked him as they went. He nodded, not looking back, still seeming wary, clearly not sure they had gotten them all on the way in.
"Yeah, though it wasn't as hard as you think. There were barely any of them left in the camp when we arrived.
Come on, this way, to the courtyards," he said, taking her hand and leading her further into the prison.
"Courtyards are in center of camp. No way out there,"
she said, and though she could not see it, Kombir grinned inside his helmet. "Don't worry, you'll see," he assured her. And, sure enough, when he opened the hatch out into the barren courtyard, her breath was taken away. Parked across the entire space, and floating, hovering on her pulsar lifts above them, was a fleet of ships. All civilian, space-worthy craft, most of which came equipped with blaster cannons, turrets, and other standard defenses. And, from the burning peeled remnants of the defense turrets and watchtowers which ringed the prison camp, it was clear that they had been used, and to great effect. Combier paused to wave everyone through and make sure no one had been left behind, ushering out prisoners into waiting ships and helping those ships take off and new ships to land when their capacity had been filled up. Javona knew that she could leave at any time from that moment, get onto any of the waiting ships that stood by. But, instead, she chose to stay near Combier, waiting for him to conclude what he was doing, intent on being on his ship by the end. She did not have to wait too long, for Combier and the others had cleared most of the prison, only thinking to check the actual execution chambers near the end of their search for survivors. His ship was no starfighter, but not as large as some of the others that had landed. Luckily for her, as far as she was concerned, Combier had no other survivors waiting on space, and so no other prisoners joined them as she followed him up the ramp to his ship. "Hey Mom, we got one passenger coming aboard," he said as they stepped inside.
"Who? A survivor?"
she asked, twisting around to look at Javona. Combier nodded and gestured back towards her. "Meet Javona," he said. Javona waved, feeling uncharacteristically shy under the woman's sudden scrutiny, which ultimately settled over her alien features approvingly. It was a novel sensation, for before now, only her own family had ever looked kindly on the small, purple ridge which crowned the center of her upper brows, or the bald, smooth expanse of her hairless head. The only two atypical features she bore.
"Good. She can man the upper turret if we get into trouble. Now, strap yourself in. I'm taking us out of here,"
said Venora, turning back to her controls and beginning the takeoff sequence, engines whining and spinning up as the two others took seats behind her and did as instructed.
You are from Axum?"
Javona asked Combier, gripping the safety restraints on her chair lightly as the ship jerked and began to float up.
"Born and raised. What about you?" he asked. She shook her head.
"Newer arrivals, me and my family. We were already running from Imperium. It had been hoped that, with Axum being so big, we could escape. But it's been hard to go unnoticed,"
Javona admitted.
"You were already running? Where do you come from?" asked Combier.
Javona pointed up towards the sky in response.
"Was born on planet called Yevon Primiris. It was safe place for a time. Then come Skywatchers and Imperium. They take us all away, kill any who they notice are different, burn our planet, and leave it with nothing. Normally is easy to hide, but with so many eyes on so few ships,"
she said, sorrow lacing her voice.
That's monstrous. Why would they do that?"
Combier asked.
"Because they fear. They fear my people and beliefs. They know Corpse God is lie, and that our gods are true. And so they kill us to try to stop them coming to us,"
she said. "They fear your gods? Who or what are your gods? Are they real things or just a belief?" Combier asked, leaning in, interested.
"They real. From between starfires they come, old and wise and true. Almost we saw them, and one was with us always. Saw him with my own eyes. They real,"
she insisted.
Suddenly, there was beeping in the control console, and Javona jerked her head forward, seeing a thick, cigar-shaped ship of immense size falling through the atmosphere, though fairly distantly from them.
"Look alive, you two! We are getting an SOS from a large ship falling out of orbit! We may be needed for emergency help," said Venora.
Javona watched as Combeer turned and looked at the controls he had access to, typing away at them for a moment. "This can't be right. Mom, that's a Confederate battlecruiser. What is it doing here?" he said after a moment.
"Let's see if we can find out. Patching them through now," she said.
Static filled the cockpit speakers, making Javona clap her hands to her ears, the devices buzzing and churning for a time as a distant-sounding voice slowly came into focus and replaced them.
"This is Ahsoka Tano, acting commander of the 501st Clone Detachment. Repeat, this is Ahsoka Tano of the Galactic Republic. We're going down and need support. Repeat, we are going down and need help angling our approach for an emergency landing. Any Republic forces, please respond!"
Javona had considerable trouble keeping up with the rapidly spoken Galactic Basic, far more fluent in the Imperial tongue, but understood enough to know that their help was needed. She looked to her rescuers, wondering what they would do now. There was a pause then, as Combeer's mother looked back at her son, and he to her. Combeer nodded, and she nodded back.
"I'll contact as many of the other ships as are willing to help. I'll put you through to that ship in a second,"
said Venora, Combeer taking a headset and removing his helmet, replacing it. "Copy that, Ahsoka Tano. This is Combeer and the Resistance Fighters of Axum. We may not be the Republic forces you're calling for, but I think we're close enough. Ships incoming to your location. Towing cables and tractor beams are prepped. If you have a particular landing location in mind, I suggest you send it to us now."
We are going back to fight?"
Javona asked nervously, though neither of the two answered her, which was answer enough. And, if that had not made it clear, the following broadcast did.
"Boy, am I glad to hear a friendly voice, forwarding our projected landing site. Fair warning, Resistance Fighters. We are not done fighting, so we plan to park this wreck right on top of them. Understood?"
Combeer barely hesitated.
"Understood, Commander. Here's hoping they're grouped tight."
"They've been chatting like that since they met," Crosshair grated.
"Yeah, and?" Wrecker asked, walking alongside and just in front of the tall sniper.
"It's unnatural,"
Crosshair hissed. Wrecker looked at him, and then forward to the two who were leading their group. They were not loud and did not seem to be slowing them down. The murmur of their voices had been near constant from the moment Tech and Quo 84 had begun speaking. Crosshair had used his comm to listen in on their gabbing, but found their conversation to be all but indecipherable. And not because the two were speaking in some other language, or using a dialect or jargon that was outside his understanding, at least for the most part. No, Crosshair could follow the words and meanings of their speech, but could not, for the life of him, locate a central theme or reasoning behind their conversation. The two appeared to be going back and forth, one delighting the other with seemingly random trivia, only barely related to the trivia that had preceded it.
"So, I was made to somehow create a baseline M-wave receiver without even an iota of Temerite ore to boost the signal,"
Quo was saying.
"An M-wave receiver without anything to conduct that kind of wavelength.
It seems to me that he was trying to cause you to fail," Tech replied. Quo nodded his head emphatically.
"Indeed, I also suspect that was the case. But I foiled that plan by using the battery casing itself to bolster the signal. Granted, it only worked after you let it heat up for a few minutes before using, but it was done in the end,"
the droid man said proudly.
"Fascinating use of recombinant ideology. I myself am quite the recombinator. We performed a delicate data extraction from Raxus Prime earlier in the war. Things did not turn out exactly as planned, stranding Crosshair and I inside a Viridium mine," the brainy clone explained.
"Oh, Viridium! I haven't heard of that ore, but it sounds volatile,"
the red-robed droid man interjected.
Extremely. Any blaster fire inside the tunnel risked a full-scale Viridium meltdown. I almost had to yank Crosshair's rifle out of his hands to keep him from atomizing us out of habit. And that was not all. Viridium is also highly radio-absorbent, blocking out our comms and leaving us without any way to signal for help. However, I realized that with controlled detonations, I could cause a radioactive feedback loop along the seams of the mine, Tech said.
And cause a signal-bolstering radiation burst born on energetic ion waves,
Quo completed. Precisely. Obviously, Crosshair and I were eating anti-radiation supplements for the next 2 months after. But it got the message across. Almost deafened Hunter, in fact. Wrecker smirked as he marched behind them, only catching scratches of the rapidly moving topics.
I don't know. I think it's kinda cute. Tech finally made a friend who's as excited about useless stuff as he is, said the larger clone, punctuating the words with a laugh.
You won't think it's so cute if they don't take us where we need to go,
Crosshair growled.
Well, where else would they be taking us? Wrecker asked.
The sniper shrugged, hidden face scowling.
On a tour of the fragging ship, for starters, he grumbled.
As if sensing the soft-spoken criticism, Quo turned back towards the two in the rear and indicated towards a door in the hallway not far from where they strode.
Fear not, friends! Our destination lies just ahead! It won't be long now,
he said. When they came close to the doors, it became obvious that they were far more reinforced than the majority of the other similar doors they had already come across. Quo approached without hesitation, extending out his tendrils and interfacing with the gate's mechanisms. And then, time began to tick by. First 1 minute, then two, and then 3 minutes passed, with the clones only growing antsier and antsier as they were made to wait in the hallway, weapons out and swiveling.
How long is this going to take, Hunter? At this point, we might as well just serve ourselves up to the imps,
Crosshair hissed. Oh, don't worry about that. It's highly unlikely they will find us now. There really shouldn't be many people wandering the ship at this point, said Tech.
What? Why?
Crosshair followed up. Tech blinked, head tilting. Obviously because the warp breach alarm has been triggered. Most of the ship's inhabitants will be inside bunkers and warded shelters by now, if not preemptively cramming themselves inside of escape pods, Tech said. Crosshair scowled at that.
Obviously. What's so obvious about any of that? What is a warp breach, and why aren't we hiding from it? And how the frag would I know any of that?
Crosshair spat. Calm down, Crosshair. I simply assumed that you had been listening in on me and Quo. He is quite insightful, and explained all of that several minutes ago. Though I'm still not sure what a warp tear is exactly, I do understand that it has to do with their FTL drives, and that it's quite dangerous. But I don't think I have to explain why we can't go into the shelters with the Imperials right now, Tech was saying before a loud, mechanical squeal cut him off, drawing all of their attentions back to the door. Quo stepped back and away from it, the many locks creaking and cracking open as the bars around it slid back and away. Soon, the passage was clear and open before them. Tech began to move forward, but Hunter halted him with an extended hand.
Hold on, Tech. I'll take point. Cover me,
he said, eyes finding Crosshair's and giving the barest nod. Crosshair returned it and subtly angled his rifle to aim at Quo's back. Tech nodded and stood back, pistols drawn to cover Hunter, as the sergeant stalked inside, past the lip of the door, and looked around. A little time passed before Hunter radioed the others.
I think you will all want to see this.
Especially you, Tech, he said. Shrugging, the others filed in, Crosshair taking up the rear behind Quo as they entered into the room. The chamber was both massively large and densely packed with all manner of computers, devices, and instruments. And, in the center of it all, half dismantled and clearly being studied, was the bomb itself.
Whoa!
Wrecker gasped excitedly.
Wait, isn't that supposed to be back on an axis?
Crosshair asked.
Hunter nodded. It is.
If it's here, then
What exactly is keeping Anaxes in line under Imperial control? The sergeant wondered aloud. The threat of the bomb appears to have been enough. As long as the people believe it's still there, then it might as well be. After all, most of the power behind a bomb this large isn't in its actual detonation, but in the threat of it. Or at least, so it would appear. The words gave Hunter a devious idea. Let's put that to the test then. Tech, Quo, can you two get this bomb operational again, quickly? The two looked at each other, and then at the bomb, before nodding in unison.
It should not be a problem, though we will need the aid of a lifter servitor.
Quo 84 said. No need, Tech replied. We've got something, or rather, someone, better. He said with a smile. Wrecker stalked forward then, laughing as he put his gun away and clapped his large hands together.
You bet you do. I'm way, way better at lifting than Trashy ever was.
The huge clone said amiably.
But, Hunter, why do we even want this thing operational? Wasn't our mission to disable it?
Crosshair asked. Hunter turned and grinned. Exactly. And there isn't a bomb that's more disabled than when we've already set off. As far as I'm concerned, this ship is as good a place as any to set it off, he said.
Doesn't anyone here think he might have an issue with that?
Crosshair asked, indicating towards Quo. The others looked at him as well, and he paused and looked behind himself before realizing he was truly the subject of their scrutiny.
I have few friends on this ship, and those I do have do not plan to remain much longer. In fact, I fully intend to depart with them before this is done. We are not far from where I need to meet them. If I aid you in this, may I be released from your escort and, as Call would say, go our separate ways?
The machine man asked.
Bad idea, said Crosshair.
Hunter paused for a moment, rubbing his chin. Tech, check the work when it's all done. If it all looks right, then yeah, you can go. I don't really understand what kind of power struggle you are involved in, but if this war has taught me anything, it's that the enemy of my enemy, Hunter began to say,
is my friend. That is also one of Call's sayings. Or at least, one I've heard him repeat ad nauseum. For what it's worth, Sergeant, I agree,
said Quo. Then get to work, both of you. Crosshair and I will cover the entrance. Let me know when you are done. Sister Legatine Reyna Ordain spiraled down and away from the falling heretic gunship, her jump pack sputtering and spitting flames and thrust, but doing so in weakening bursts. The packs were not meant for true, sustained flight, and she had already tested hers to the limit during her bout with the alien witch. Controlling her own fall, she burned down towards the ground at speeds which would have pulped the flesh of a normal human, colliding with the metal avenue in a shower of shimmering fragments and fire. Her armor compensated for the impact with a loud, mechanical hiss, and she stood from her landing crouch almost without pause, seeing that the armor of the clones she had landed on had not protected their frail bodies as her blessed plate had done for her. Sword held aloft, she cut through the smoke to strike the stunned survivors of the squad she had fallen upon, first one and then the other. But as soon as she cut down those nearest her, the spire winds blew away the smoke around her, revealing a grouped mass of 40 clones. They held grenade and missile launchers, weapons they had trained on her from the moment she saw them. She grit her teeth, her face tightening as her life once more met the razor's edge, pivoting towards the group and raising her sword. They fired. Reyna knew that she did not have enough power left in her pack to fly away into safety, but knew also that it was not fully expended, not yet. Even now, the energy cells of her power suit's generator were helping to bolster the jump pack which was mounted over it. But even so, it would take her precious seconds to emulate flight once more, seconds she simply did not have. So instead, she charged, eyes tracking the missiles and noting that they were joined by arching mortars as well. munition salvos set to break her apart like an egg struck with firecrackers. But while her pack lacked the power to carry her far into the air, it did have enough strength stored up to launch her forward and to the left. An action she waited until the very last second to perform, throwing herself just out of the way of the streaking projectiles, which curved in an attempt to follow her, but too late. The missiles collided into the street behind her, and the sudden overlapping explosions which followed as a result of the raining mortars only seemed to help propel her forward, and closer to the clones. They fired again, and then a third time, each time finding their weapons just barely evaded by the last second rocket sprints of the sister, which carried her into their number like a bullet flying into a body. The aftermath of the impact was bloody and lethal, with Reyna's voice ringing out in clear song as she lopped away limbs, bisected torsos, and divided faces and halves, turning living resistance into pacified death. The clone formation broke apart around her, and those which did not flee were mercilessly shown the Emperor's peace. And soon, all that remained of that skirmish was the Sister Legatine and the pile of bodies she stood atop. Looking around, she was somewhat relieved to find the battle lines falling back and away from her position as Imperial forces began to push back the Republican advance. Thanks to the sudden aid provided by their reinforcements and the flanking positions those reinforcements had chosen to take up when entering the battle, the heretical forces of endless clones had not just been stalled, but nearly decapitated. The spear of their forward assault dissolving into disorganized chaos all around her. To their credit, the enemy soldiers did not rout, forming into clumps of stubborn resistance which were gradually being surrounded by advancing Vestilian irregulars, who then took them apart until none remained standing. The Vasties had taken a brutal beating in defense of the approach to the Basilica, and despite their reputation as a more tepid, cautious force of guardsmen, they seemed more than eager to repay their losses back to the unyielding Replicate warriors, showing no quarter and no lack of haste as they took back ground while simultaneously taking their lives. And now they were not alone, joined by the silent forward march of the Carcosan Untouchables, most of whom had massed to the left and right of the opposing forces. Those few untouchables which had arrived in the center of the field took up shock rolls, hitting the forward-facing enemies hard and without consideration for personal losses. With their additions to the battle, it seemed the surprise assault and assassination-borne sabotage of the Republic had finally yielded its last advantages, and Imperial grit and faith was now making the difference. The thoughts were nearly enough to bring a bristling smile to her face, but the sudden trembling within the earth curtailed her joy. Her Auspex picked it up first, but it was not long before she felt it as well. Evidently, the Republic Replicate felt whatever this approaching force was as well, as their groups, clumps, lines, and formations began to dissolve, launching themselves into assaults on the flanking buildings, breaching and escaping into them as they vacated the wide street. And then she saw them. At first, Reyna had thought she was witnessing the approach of large, low-flying starships, the likes of which she had seen before during their invasion. The repulsive, artificial gravity technology mastered by the aliens allowed them to create utterly impractical designs to fly through the air and hover at will. And she mistook the tanks for such craft, only realizing her error as it became clearer and clearer that these vessels were speeding, not on cushions of air and technology, but on 10 gargantuan spinning wheels.
Forward, forces! Incoming heretic super heavy support is inbound on the main approach! Brace for impact!
She yelled through her vox relay, metal shards crunching and screeching underfoot as she dashed to the smoking wreckage of one of the trundling, walking Republic tanks, taking cover behind it just as these new enormous tanks began to fire.
First came volleys upon volleys of missile sprays, most of which were directed into the battle lines of her fellow sisters. Thanks to her warning, many had taken cover ahead of the sudden assault, but for too many, the warning had not come soon enough, or the cover they had chosen was simply insufficient. But the true devastation began when the many heavy plasma particle turrets which were mounted on these behemoths began to open fire. Additional sprays of death emerged, this time in the form of wide blue blaster bolts which hammered into the Vestellan and Carcosan lines, cutting them down with frightening efficiency. Those few sisters that found themselves in the line of fire for those Azure weapons fared little better. For these weapons were clearly of a wholly different caliber than the handheld blasters the Replica had been using before. Only exacerbating the matters, the huge tanks were speeding at nearly 80 miles an hour, and they did not stop when they collided with the foremost ranks of the Imperium's soldiers. Reyna found herself crying out in fear and fury as one of the assault tanks drove straight over where she huddled, crushing and denting the ruined walker under five successive metallic wheels, each large enough to smash her flat. She covered her head as the walker corpse above her crinkled and bent, its metal screaming under the strain, but remaining intact enough that she was still whole and not smashed like an insect by the time the speeding, wheeled fortress had passed overhead. Those tanks took back the Republic's ground in brutal fashion, their thick hull plating throwing back very nearly everything the Imperium threw into them, and shrugging off what weapons fire managed to actually stick. When they finally stopped advancing, hatches and ramps deployed from each of the three leading vehicles, 300 fresh Replicate heretics emerging from each. The troopers immediately re-engaging the stunned Imperial soldiers with alien battle cries and weapons fire. And, to add dismay to Reyna's already growing rage, she felt the rumbling had not stopped, even after they had arrived, and looking back down the avenue, saw three more of such tanks rapidly approaching their already haphazard battle lines. A chime from her armor declared her jump pack fully charged, and not a moment too soon. Win or lose, death or divinity, Reyna did not doubt her purpose for a second, even if she did doubt the likelihood of her success. These were monsters which threatened to turn back the loyal and the faithful, and to such monsters, she was doom incarnate! Reyna Ordain charged down the avenue, the fresh fight at her back, angling herself towards one of the approaching behemoth tanks. Missiles were fired, some even at her, and she again waited until the very last moment before activating her jump jets, sailing high into the sky and arching down towards the command bridge of the tank she had chosen. Using every last iota of her brain power to calculate her impact point, she threw her still-powered sword through the front of the vehicle and curled herself into a ball, throwing herself at full speed towards the viewing window of thick, transparent steel which crowned the command center. The impact jarred her, nearly tearing her left arm from her socket and numbing her right leg as her body burst into the tank in a shower of glass-like substance and ceramite chips. The sister did not doubt that, had her sword not weakened the wide, transparent viewing port, she would have done little more than collide like an insect against their windshield. Reyna tried to rise, but staggered, servos whining and sputtering after all the abuse. The uniformed command crew of the tank blinked in utter shock at the collapsed figure which had shattered her way into their midst, no one doing much of anything as seconds hung suspended in the air like frozen rain. But that pause ended as one of the commanding clones drew his sidearm and began discharging into the Imperial warrior, his actions prompting the other officers to do the same, drawing blaster pistols and firing into her. The bolts pinged and sizzled into her splintered armor, filling her with the sense of being pelted by heavy, boiling rain, which gradually superheated her shell, even scalding and burning her through the seams. Discarding her reliance on mechanical muscles, she hauled herself up with a strained growl of effort, throwing herself against the nearest clone. Grasping and pulling free her weapon, which was embedded in the floor near her, sword impaling the man's chest with barely a strain, his eyes wide, mouth agape, and spewing blood as she pulled the blade out of him through the side of his punctured chest. But she was no longer looking at him, finding her next target and lurching in his direction, screaming in pain as the heat within her suit began to grow near intolerable. The next man she beheaded, kicking the head into the face of another clone as she went for the third kill, cutting the arms off the next assailant, jump jets burning to fill the space with smoke as she tried to provide some sort of concealment for herself. Without helmets or armor of their own, the clone officers were easy prey to her auspex, which guided her through the smoke, and to each of them in turn, even as they continued to shoot after her, following the glow of her blade to try to keep their bead. But their uniforms and sidearms were a bad matchup, even for a crippled sister. She slammed her elbow into the wall beside the hatch that led down into the rest of the vehicle, a blood-strewn mire stretching out behind her. Reyna pushed air from between her teeth, gritting them in a cage of enameled bone as she pushed through the heat, searing pain and bruises she had earned from her latest assault. Though the command deck had seemed vacated, the tank did not stop its movement or attack. Grunting in frustration, she stabbed her blade into the wall, unholstering a bolt pistol from her hip and spinning on her heel, unloading the gun into the nearby consoles, bursting and blowing them all apart. Yet, even this did nothing to slow or stall the Republic war machine. But she also resolved to not be slowed or stalled by this either. She would stop this monster, even if she had to tear out its guts from the inside. Holstering her gun, she retrieved her sword and slammed her fist against the door control panel. It squealed open in response, revealing the white-helmed face of a trooper who was about to enter. Yeah! Reyna roared into his face as she pushed her blade through the stunned false man and into the replicate behind him, triggering her blade's power field to flare as she slid the sword out, bursting both of them apart. Blue blaster bolts chased and collided with her through the misting gore which coated either wall in the cramped space. There was no room to evade or maneuver in this thing, so she did not bother to try. Charging through the shots, shoulder leading the way as she tackled the troopers attempting to impede her in the narrow hallway. Reyna crushed white armor with the power of squealing, struggling servos, before turning about and lopping down with her blue sword's glowing blade. The Sister Legatine discarded grace, embracing brutality as she hacked and chopped through armor and flesh, striking the walls to either side with each attack and leaving long, melting furrows in her wake. A clone tackled her in return, ramming the barrel of his gun into her shoulder joint as he did, screaming as he fired. Her right shoulder seized up at this and was filled with blinding pain. She used that pain to power a headbutt which shoved the man back, following that up by punching into him with her left arm, her blade slipping from her right hand's fingers and embedding itself in the floor. Her gauntleted strike broke every rib in the man's chest, dropping him to the ground, wheezing and dying. The soldiers behind her opened fire, and she barely shielded her face from the deathly blue volley, raising her left arm to defend herself as she tried to work some kind of feeling into her right arm. Reyna was roasting alive and screamed her pain and fury as she charged forward again, ramming into the closest replicae, knocking he and his brothers back and over, though she found herself falling over with them. The close range blasting devolved into a brutal grappling melee, the clones attempting to use their numbers against her. They tried to pin her down, to put their weight over her as they shoved their guns into the seams of her armor, blaster barrels seeking to press against any part of her skin or face. But the searing pain from those attempts only fueled her fury, her rage becoming the death song of all she faced. Within the main body of the troop-carrying compartment, clones listened to the struggle occurring behind the doors which led into them. Angling blasters, listening to the hymns of death and the cries of fleeting life which almost certainly belonged to their brothers. And then, silence. They waited, braced into overlapping fields of fire, at least as much as the cramped confines would allow them. When the doors slid open, they revealed only inky darkness, the lights in the corridor having been destroyed in the fight. "Sergeant?" one of the clones called. In response, two double-fist-sized cylindrical objects bounced out of the shadows, landing at the feet of the waiting clones.
"Grenade!"
the nearest clone began to call, but the explosives had been cooked and provided him no more time than that. They detonated, one expelling smoke and glittering, blinding flares, while the other combusted into a raining fireball of burning, searing phosphor, the purifying substance spreading out like the wings of a merciless phoenix. Its avian cry carried on the sudden, frantic screams of the troopers who felt its touch. Blinded by light, smoke, and fire, they were unprepared to carry out their planned defense as the avatar of the Emperor's intolerance made itself known through the divine instrument that was Reyna Ordain. Minutes later, the Juggernaut would cease its offensive action, having reached its assault position before going silent. It was surrounded by fellow Juggernaut tanks who, even then, not only fired into the enemy positions, but opened their disembarkation ramps, releasing their hordes of hundreds of replicae into the front line of the battle. The troopers of the Republic had expected to see the same emerge from this tank as well, forming up for the continuing forward march. But when the ramp came down, the first thing to emerge was blood, smoke, and the diced, burnt remains of the men who had died too close to the exit. Pools of red flowed down as columns of black were belched out and up. The rolling trundle of a severed, still-helmed head and the awkward, downward, flopping roll of a dismembered white limb were joined by the staggered, limping steps of Sister Reyna, who emerged, clutching her sword in her left hand, her hair and armor thickly matted with the blood of just over 300 clone troopers. Smoking from every inch, one eye closed against the searing burn, Reyna turned to spitefully regard the clones who gawked at her emergence from the slain tank. Her armor hummed and strained, barely able to keep up with her desired movements now, dragged after her with each plodding attempt she made to approach. All she could do was stand, unbowed, and glare at them, an omen of their futility. She could not even raise her sword properly any longer, not even in her good arm. But she showed the surrounding enemy no fear. Instead, when they lifted their blaster barrels towards her, she faced them with a defiant, monstrous glare and roared her battle cry. Though she could not do more than just that. And yet, she needed no more than that. No more at all. It was as if her call had heralded doom itself. For as she let loose her final cry, the steel earth around her seemed to scream back at them, expanding and bursting apart in fiery detonations which scattered the clones present with the force of surprise and deadly power. Several replicae still managed to send shots up at Reyna, which made her grunt as they seared her and impacted onto her chest plate, cracking the already worn down and scorched ceramite as she fell back against the ramp. The sound of battle surrounded her then, and, most notably, the squeal and sigh of mechanical legs and the deep-throated thrums of vehicle-scaled grenade launchers.
A form loomed over her, and it jerked suddenly as she became aware of it, her eyes blinking rapidly to make it out. A man with a scarred face, a young man. He was in a black uniform, and, to her relief, he was clearly an Imperial soldier. Reyna was so relieved, she almost did not release the sudden vice grip she had seized the man with. Having wrapped her armored left-hand fingers around his throat without realizing it. She winced and let him go, and he rubbed his neck and grimaced, but reached down to help her up. Luckily, they were not alone, several other similarly dressed men crowding around her to pull her up into their arms, helping to support her copious weight once they managed to drag her upright. She looked around through hazy eyes as sentinel walkers fought around them, temporarily driving the soldiers back and away while larger munitions fired from weapons she could not see collided with the super-heavy Republic tanks. That seemed to keep them occupied as they carried her away to a waiting Chimera transport, and the sister Hospitaller waiting inside.
What? What regiment?
She groaned the nearest man, the man who had found her first. He smiled devilishly at her, seemingly unconcerned with her nearly breaking his neck earlier. The young man was actually quite handsome, or would have been past the four raking lines which marked his whole face from one diagonal to the other.
Black Arminians, 44th Obsidian Guard, here to do the Emperor's work, he said.
And as she was carried away, she saw that he spoke truly, as the sound of crunching tank treads, booming Lehman Russ turrets, and the rumble and roar of something far deeper and far larger entered into her senses.
Rest easy, sister. Faith and fury may sustain the fight, but our guns will end it, he said.
There was an air-shattering blast then, one which sent the wind whipping and screeching about them, making the Hospitaller flinch back, though the Black Carminians did not even twitch. Sister Reyna Ordain watched from over the soldier's shoulder as the entire head and half the body of a Republic turbo tank seemed to simply vanish, rent apart by the supersonic passage of the solid shells which had sailed through it. The man was still smiling.
Our very big guns.
I've got the reach and the teeth of a killing machine, with the need to bleed you when the light goes green. Best believe I'm in the zone to be, from a yin to my yang to Z. Put a grin on my chin when you come to me, cause I'll weird, I'm a one of a kind, and I'll bring death to the place you're about to weep. Another river of blood running under my feet. In a fire lit long ago. Stand next to me, you'll never stand alone. I'm last to leave, but the first to go. Lord, make me dead before you make me whole. I feed on the fear of the devil inside, of the enemy faces in my sight. Aim with a hand, shoot with a mind, kill with a heart like Arctic ice. And a fire in me like a cigarette thrown to gasoline. If death don't bring you fear, I swear you'll fear these marching feet. Come to the nightmare, come to me. Deep down in the dark where the devil be. In the mall where the jaws and the razor teeth. Where the brimstone burns and the angel weeps. Call to the gods of across your path. And my silhouette hangs like a body bag. Hope is a moment now long past. The shadow of death is the one I cast. I am a soldier and I'm marching on. I am a warrior and this is my song. My eyes are steel and my gaze is long.
I cannot hear you.
I am a warrior and this is my song.
We're not just going to shoot the bastard. We're going to cut out their living guts and use them to grease the treads of our tanks. murder those lousy bastards by the bush.
Now I'm in bleeding, I mean to inflict the grief, and the least of me is still out of your reach. The killer machine's gonna do the deed until the river runs dry and my last breath leaves. Chin in the air with a head held high, I'll stand in the path of the enemy line. Feel no fear, know my pride, for God and country I'll end your life.
Temples high and trails of pain. For more.